everybody. Good morning. Give yourselves a hand for rolling out of bed today on a holiday. We'll call Brandon back up here to the piano. It gives us some nice, happy music. Somebody grab Brandon. We are ready to kick this off. Almost right on time, and so I'm glad the snow has melted. I'm Kimberly Warren with MidCity Excellence Community Learning Center.
I'm Wes Simmons. I'm with the 3D Institute, also representing the Joseph Company here in St. Joseph.
And we are brothers and sisters. Woohoo! We are going to just give you some little housekeeping things for today, and we want to welcome you to the 8th Annual Solutions Summit for Martin Luther King, Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King. We're going to hear a lot of quotes today, and we're going to talk about the dream living on, but we all know the dream can't live on without a dream team. That's you, that's me, that's the parents, that's the school district, the chamber, that's the college, that's everybody here, the churches, and the people that could not come today, but that are live streaming on the MidCity Excellence Plays page. Please sign in there and please share it with someone who could not make it. We have a couple things in your program where everybody can participate. We have some wonderful sponsors from Red Lobster to Bullock Family Chapel to many, many, many more. You can see the sponsors on your programs. But if you register today, every few minutes when you see the green pop up, I will come up here and pass out those gift certificates for you and your family. We have movie passes. We have so much more, and we would like to share that with you because of our sponsors. So if you have the capacity to take a picture of this QR code, which I just learned about yesterday, thank you, Lamina and Wes and his team for bringing us into the 21st century. You merely have to take a picture of that code. The first one is for your contact sheet, so you can find out the monthly events, and some of them are going to be daily as MidCity goes from 3 to 6 every single day and some weekends. And so we would like to keep in contact with you. So you do not have to complete the forms on your paper if you scan this code and have the capacity to do it in just 60 seconds electronically. So the first code is for your registration. And then the second one is for giving at the end of the program and in case you have to leave earlier than the event. It goes from about 11 a.m. to 1, depending upon how fast they play and how fast they dance. And so we have some wonderful guest speakers who are here today, and I know we are all here just to have a spirit of unity today and to celebrate the life and the legacy of Dr. Martin Luther King.
Just a couple housekeeping events or items. First, as soon as the prayer is done, you will be dismissed to go to the tables. We've got tables on both sides, plenty of food, load up. Bathrooms are out that back door and to the left, just follow the signs. And I just wanted to give a couple shout-outs here. First, to Word of Life Church for hosting this event. I know we've got many of their staff here, so please give it up to them. Thank you so much for that. And then I'd also like to shout out Zub's Catering in the back, who has donated the labor for all the food that we're going to be able to eat. It's going to be great food. And so please give a shout-out to Zub's Catering.
At this time, we're going to ask Pastor James Foster III to come up and open up the program with a blessing for the day and a blessing for good health and for our food and those that prepared it at Cubs Catering, Zub's Catering. Pastor James Foster, my brother.
Good morning. Good afternoon, everyone. It's good to see all your beautiful faces. And let's go before the Lord in prayer and ask for His blessing on the day. And you can just look across the room, and He has blessed us with a lot of unity and a lot of love in this room. Give yourself another hand clap for answering the call of love from the Lord. Let's bow our heads. Lord Jesus, we thank you. The word says how good and pleasant it is for brethren to dwell in unity. We thank you for unity. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your everlasting mercies and your loving kindness. Lord, we ask that you fulfill every need in this room, fulfill every need of the underprivileged in this city, in this town, in this world. Lord, you cared for the least, so we pray and we ask for abundant blessings financially, mentally, spiritually, most of all. And we bless this food that it nourish our bodies. And we pray, Lord, that we get stronger. We pray that we even have strength over this plague. In the name of Jesus, we pray and thank you for this day. And thank you for your delivering and healing and your salvation power. In Jesus' name, everybody said, amen.
We'll have you get up at this time. We'll ask the Mid-City kids to wait because you're going to be the first on program. So we'll ask everyone else to get up for the next 10 or 15 minutes and make sure you get something to eat. And then we will come right back with Cynthia McCallan and Brandon Birch with Lift Every Voice. Actually, let's go in and have them do that now. Cynthia McCallan, they call her the singing nurse. She has sung many people home to Jesus. She is a hospice nurse for Mosaic, and she is going to sing today. So we'll go on and put the words up if you would like to join in.
Testing, testing, testing. Hey, all right, a beautiful day. Hello, I am Cynthia McCallan. I am not shy, okay? We are so glad to be here. Brandon Birch is just getting his mic together, and we're going to, because I'm not singing without Brandon, if y'all have heard this voice. and then my sister Kimberly. So it's a blessing to be before you. On this beautiful occasion. Sorry, you have to kind of work with us sometimes. Us musicians, we're great at what we do, but certain things we just don't get. Amen? But that's why we have amazing people out there that say, put the other mic in the stand. All right? Especially when you haven't had sleep, you know? All right, but...
Unborn had died, yet with us they let's all stand and sing this last verse. Amen.
Table at this time and get a little vittles and come right back to your seat. We'll start with the Mid-City video, and that's when you know it's time to get started again. God bless you.
Bird. you, Jesus, for blessing me. I just want to praise you forever and ever and ever. Blessings and glory and honor, they all belong to you. Thank you, Jesus, for blessing me. I just want to praise you. Blessings and glory and honor, they all belong to you. Blessings and glory and honor, they all belong to you. Blessings and glory and honor, they all belong to you. Thank you, Jesus, for blessing me. I just want to praise you forever and ever and ever for all you've done. You've done for me. And glory and honor, they all belong to you. Blessings and glory and honor, they all belong to you. Blessings and glory and honor, they all belong to you. Thank you, Jesus. 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 Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you.
so much. Let's give Cynthia McCallan and Brandon Birch a hand. Just let employers know right now, Aaron, as you're queuing up the Mid-City Genius video, Brandon is graduating in May. Everybody say, stay in St. Joe. Gosh, you guys, we got to keep him here. He's been the Mid-City Music and Choir Director for 3 or 4 years. He's going to have an education degree soon. Kansas City is his home, but we sure need him here as a mentor. So I don't know. Help me out. I don't have a big budget. I really don't. But help me out. Somebody tell Brandon we need him and we love him. Thank you. And right now, we're going to show you the other geniuses that live here, the Mid-City video. Right after that, I need the St. Joe Sticks drummers to come and take the stage and show us a little something, something. So right now, thank you so much for Word of Life for letting us have our event here. And Aaron is going to show you a little something, something, something good in the hood.
Kimberly Warren, the CEO and founder of MidCity Excellence Community Learning Center. MCE's mission is to transition at-risk youth into adulthood by providing academic support, emotional stability, and by helping them discover value and purpose through Christian-based principles. Come on in, let's show you around.
Friends, we get to enjoy like the kids are doing. We get to talk like kind of an adult, but we're not actually an adult. It's actually fun than being at home and be bored and just thinking about what you should do. It's actually entertaining.
Yeah, it's important that we're role models for the kids and that they have somebody to come to and they don't feel like they can go to their parents. Just become a safe place for them and to really be role models.
I think the most rewarding part about working for MidCity Excellence is just seeing the joy on the kids' faces each week when they come in, come through the door, or when you introduce a new song or a new dance to them. Oh, Mr. Brandon, I practiced this dance and I'm ready to dance now. So it's just kind of just their enthusiasm towards the program. Brings joy to me and knowing that we're making a difference in each of their lives. Shoot, the kids get out whatever they can get out of it, you know. It's just something about, because a lot of them come from the best households, so when you come to an environment that is pretty steady and can offer you things that you can't get at home, it's pretty mind-opening and it's pretty, it's different, to say the least.
I like to call it an escape from everyday routines in life. They get to just come and play and have fun and just be themselves and learn a little bit of, you know, get help with their schoolwork at the same time.
Honestly, I think the kids, they love it. They get to put their hair down, so to speak, and get a breath of fresh air, have time, just unload for some stress as well.
Hi, my name is Colby Thornton. I know you might be going through a lot right now. You might not have the best parents or live in the best situation, but you can get through this. No matter what you face, you ultimately decide who you become. And I know this because I've done it. But you don't have to do this alone. A great support system can go a long way in helping you be successful, whether that be teachers, friends, or a community like MidCity. MidCity offered me great support through stepping, choir, and through their awesome staff like Mrs. Kim and Pastor Warren. And they ultimately pushed me to further myself and graduate second in my class and be able to go to college for free. So like I said, no matter what you are facing, you decide who you become.
Hey, what's up, guys? My name is JP. A little bit about me. I'm a professional dancer and hip-hop choreographer. I've traveled all around the world doing a lot of shows and dance competitions with a lot of main known artists. But I do want to give a huge shout out to MidCity, man, because when I was a teenager, they started a stomp team, and I've always had a desire to dance, but never really had a place to do it at. And once they started a stomp team, that gave me a doorway to express myself and to do what I love to do. And also to give me vision to say, hey, I can do this as a career versus me doing something I don't want to do. So yeah, man, I just want to give them a huge shout out because I'm a living example of being impacted by what they are doing in the community. So I just want to say I love you guys. Keep doing what you're doing because what you're doing is awesome. And yeah, we appreciate you. Peace.
Thank you for stopping by. In order to contact us and to help us inspire a generation of excellence, go to visitmce.org. That's visitmce.org. Thank you for watching, and we hope to hear from you soon.
Thank you so much. We're going to have St. Joe Sticks come right now with Pastor Robert Warren, who is the co-founder of MidCity Excellence. Come on, MidCity Sticks, let's take the stage. MidCity Excellence is just 20 years old now. We started off with trash cans and buckets, and look at this. As they're getting ready, we're going to have our ushers go around and start picking up their registration packets. I have movie passes that are just burning hot up here we got to get rid of. So right after St. Joe Sticks, we'll give our first prize giveaway. Again, if you came in a little late, we got a QR code for you to scan it. You're going to do an electronic contact. Because we are a 501c3, 51% of everybody that we engage in and serve have to be challenged, at risk, economically disadvantaged in one way. Right now, we have about 90% that we serve in our community center. However, as you heard me say earlier, we have some youth that are making straight A's. We have some youth that are excelling in the schools. And we have some challenges to overcome before graduation and before we have Missouri Western in the house, before they're ready for Missouri Western and Hilliard's. And so we are making sure that we transition them from youth to adulthood, and that they are mentally stable, that they are healthy, that they are well prepared for the workforce. At this time, we give you Pastor Reverend Robert Ward, my husband.
All right, good morning, everyone. Welcome again to our annual MLK celebration. Of course, he said he had a dream where that his four little children would not be judged by the judged by the color of the skin, but by the content of their character. And so you see here, so many years later, that we have a diverse group of young folk, and they are very energetic, and we use our energy and we put it into drums. We can beat on something, which is good, you know. So welcome to St. Joe Sticks. I hope you enjoy. Thank you.
Thank you.
you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. One more time. Thank you so much. We're going to ask Mr. David Foster to come to the stage as they exit. Some of them are coming back to dance. Isaac, wave your hand. Isaac's only five. He just turned five right here. Isaac is our youngest member. Raina, now with the purple hair, is a sophomore at Missouri Western in education. So we have a range of kids. And speaking of education, we have Mr. David Foster, who is a good, good friend of mine from the St. Joseph's School Board. And we're going to ask him to take the stage.
That was awesome. So we'd like to take this time to show our appreciation for all of you in attendance and the celebration of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. We'll also acknowledge some of our distinguished guests, supporters, and elected officials. Please stand when you hear your name. I'm going to ask that you hold your applause until the end. MCE board members, please stand. Buchanan County Sheriff Bill Pewitt, Police Chief Christopher Canale, Jeff Jakely, Pastor of United Methodist Church, Tama Wagner, St. Joseph Community Alliance, Whitney Lanning, Director of Community Action Partnership, of course, our Mayor of the City of St. Joseph, Bill McMurray, Scott Meyerhofer, and Michael Meyerhofer of Meyerhofer Funeral Homes, Ron Hook, County Commissioner, Eileen Houston Stewart, who has a tough job, Director of Communications with the St. Joseph School District, former state representative and former school board president, Martin Rucker, and his wife, Lavelle Rucker, current president of the school board, Tammy Paisley, St. Joseph School District board member candidate, Isara Garcia, St. Joseph School District former superintendent Melody Smith, mayor candidate Gary Wilkinson, and former city councilman, Chamber of Commerce president Natalie Redman, symphony director Lori McAllister, John Josendale, mayor candidate, Latanya Williams, St. Joseph School District board member, MCE board member, David Foster, school board member. I thought I saw him somewhere. Please give them a round of applause. Next up, I'll ask you all to stand for someone who supports every event and someone I'm going to miss here in a couple of months, our mayor of the city of St. Joseph, Bill McMurray.
Well, this is my last one. I've sure enjoyed coming to these every year, and I hope you'll allow me to keep coming, even though I'll be a civilian in future years. Well, this is a proclamation for MidCity Community Learning Center and the Joseph Company's 8th Annual Martin Luther King Jr. Solutions Summit Recognition Day. And whereas Pastor Robert and Kimberly Warren and the MidCity Excellence Community Learning Center board and team have designed culturally sensitive, engaging, and empowering community forums that promote racial harmony, unity, social justice, conflict resolution, and diversity in the workplace. And whereas MidCity Excellence has served over 2,300 youth and adults since 2001, that's an applause, right? Wow. In tutoring, mentoring, and enrichment community programs, including the St. Joe Sticks that we just heard, MCE Praise Dancers, and other initiatives to counteract juvenile delinquent behavior, school dropout, and poor mental health through culturally competent enrichment education. Now, therefore, I, Bill McMurray, by virtue of the authority vested in me as mayor of the city, do hereby proclaim today, Monday, January the 17th, as MidCity Excellence Community Learning Centers and the Joseph Company's 8th Annual Martin Luther King Jr. Solutions Summit Recognition Day, And I said all that in one breath, by the way. That's my musical training. In St. Joseph, Missouri, the 17th day of January, 2022. Here we go.
Thank you. Well, come here. He does a mean God bless America. Maybe next time we'll put you on program.
Oh, all right.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. We're going to ask the co-ed dancers, which we call the Mid-City Angels, to come at this time under the direction of Mama Jay Alford. While they're coming, we have three contact forms. Again, some are online, some are in person. If you haven't finished your contact form, but the first drawing goes to New Shell Chance for Red Lobster. Thank you, Tiffany Grayson, May Grayson, the manager at Red Lobster. The first one goes to, where's Miss Dr. Chance from Missouri Western State University? Would you give this to her, Pastor Warren? $30. Thank you, Red Lobster, for supporting us. And we also have our husband. There are Mid-City parents. Demetrius helped design our programs today. Don't steal them from me. Don't steal them. He has our program, I Can See You. Thank you for being our videographer today. And then the second one is Dr. Melody Smith. I don't know if we can do that one. Dr. Melody Smith is our former superintendent of schools and our board member at this time. I'm sure we're going to have a conflicts of interest policy meeting. I have hours of policy meetings. The next one is James Taylor. We have gift certificates from Cracker Barrel. So thank you all for participating. And I'm going to get off the stage and give room for the Mid-City Angels. Brandon, can you move this out of the way, or it may get in the way? Just put it down on the floor, maybe, because they're done with the drums. They have a radical performance called I Want It All Back. And with the challenges we've had with school, with mental health, with traumas, with losing people, with the pandemic, they are coming back for round two. They're standing on a firm platform because of you and their presentation. Mama J is Jay Alford, who is a recent graduate at Missouri Western and now a podcast producer with Sweet Fish. If we could ever give her back to St. Joseph, that we could really serve 300 people in this year. So everybody help us do that. Thank you for being back, Mama J.
Jump to your feet right now! Oh! For the kingdom suffering violence, but the violent, take it by force! Let's go! Yeah! We gonna take it back! We'll be right back.
I think they're going to snatch it back this time. We forgot to, I mentioned her name, but we forgot to recognize the college's president, Dr. Elizabeth Kennedy. Thank you for being here today and your esteemed colleagues. Thank you so much. James Taylor, I've got some Golden Corral Cracker Barrel. Where's James Taylor? Is he still in the house today? James Taylor? Okay, We'll find them later. At this time, we are going to have Wes Simmons come back to the stage and take the program from here. Let's give it up for our wonderful sponsors this year, 3D Institute and the Joseph Company. Wes Simmons.
Wasn't that great? The Joseph Company is a collaboration of dreamers in our community. Those who are find themselves in a leadership capacity, and together we're uniting to pursue a dream of a better St. Joseph, a better Northwest Missouri, and a dream where our people are gathering to represent all people and work together on a plan to create a unity in purpose, an alignment of effort, speaking a common language around a shared framework. A framework that empowers everybody in our community to thrive, body, mind, and spirit. It's a dream for unity across all existing barriers in our community, and I think that I would like to think that Dr. King, if he was here amongst us as we gather, he'd feel very much at home amongst this company of dreamers, because that's what he was. In fact, in his famous I Have a Dream speech, he's given us all a healthy prescription to follow if we want to strive together for that type of unity. It was quoted earlier. I'll quote it again. He said, "I have a dream that my four children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character." What a powerful and beautiful vision for the ideal. Sadly, this compelling vision of the future gets mocked and derided with every act of racism and injustice that gets perpetuated against people of color in our land. That's why Dr. King also said things like this: "There comes a time when silence is betrayal." That's something that arrests me as a white man in this community, and I've contemplated that, I've wrestled with that. And especially as a white member of our community, I've been asking myself, how can I join the fight for unity in a meaningful way? How should people like me, that look like me, speak out in a way that actually helps the cause? Well, first of all, I think that we need to be very thoughtful in how we speak. And before we open our mouths or start pecking away on keyboards, we need to make sure that our minds are wide open and our hearts are wide open first. Then we need to listen. We need to learn. We need to contemplate. What's it like to be the other? We need to empathize. When necessary, we need to grieve. And maybe most importantly, we need to turn off and tune out the propaganda machines of both the left and the right that seeks to do one thing: control the narrative and keep us divided. MLK's dream was for a day when people would not be judged by the content. No, excuse me. MLK's dream was for a day that people would be judged by the content of their character, not by the content of a caricature. And as the propaganda bombs continue to explode in 2022 America, the agenda seems to be that which it's always been: caricaturize and polarize. So how can we get beyond the caricatures? How can we get beyond the stereotypes? And first, let me say this, and this is for everybody in the room. If we don't have any real and meaningful relationships, real world relationships, with other people from different races, from different ethnicities, people that don't look like us, then that has to be step one. It's intentional. We have to engage. We have to become friends. We need to, most importantly, learn each other's stories. If we will engage others to learn more about their experiences, we'll find out that there's much more that unites us than divides us. We find others in our community who share in our hopes and in our fears. We find husbands, wives, mothers, and fathers who all want the same thing for their kids that we want for ours. This is the Solutions Summit, right? Sometimes the solution might be that simple, at least the starting point. We have to reach out. We have to engage. We have to get out of our comfort zones and seek to build meaningful relationships across all types of barriers. If we do, there will be more great stories like the one that you're about to hear now. I'm excited to introduce you to two of my friends. David Tollefson, former NFL football player, played at Northwest Missouri State, a guy that I had the good fortune of coaching in his first year there. And after his career, he got drafted by the Green Bay Packers and then spent, how many years, Dave, with the Giants? 5 years with the Giants, where he won not one, but two Super Bowls. Most importantly, both of those were against the Patriots and Tom Brady. So, you know, as a Chiefs fan, we got to give him some props. And Kenny Onatolu, I've known him for about a year now, I'd say. Kenny played for the Minnesota Vikings, the Carolina Panthers. He's the father of three young biracial children. And he's passionate about solving the racial issues that divide America today. He now devotes his energy to helping children at an early age to accept all kinds of people. He lives in Omaha, Nebraska, where he's a real estate investor and active in his church. He volunteers for his coach, his son's, as a coach for his son's football team. But as I mentioned, he helps educate children. He's a recent author. He's a recent author. Yeah, I can talk. And he recently wrote a children's book called Two of a Kind. And so it chronicles the friendship, the unlikely friendship of these two guys. And I'm excited for them to come here. Welcome me. Grab a stool on the way out, guys. I'll move this. But will you guys give it up for Dave and Kenny as they're going to share a few things about racial reconciliation? Also, the food line's closing. If anybody wants some more food, last call.
You want to start with our song that we sing?
He's kidding. I'm joking.
He can sing really good, actually.
I'm okay.
We always kind of start doing these types of conversation with something that's really interesting as far as both of us. One of us grew up in what you would probably call a nuclear family. Mom, dad, brother, sister. Father was a professor. Grew up in the Midwest. And the American dream, as you so-called, you would call that, right?
Right. The other of us grew up in the inner city of California, slept on concrete floors, real rough neighborhood, alternative school, single-parent household.
And I think typically in the world that we live in, you would probably stereotypically think that the black man standing up here grew up in the single-parent household and the white kid had a nigger family. Well, you're wrong. I've never met my father. He left my mother before I was born. I have a twin sister and a little brother, and I grew up just east of Oakland in a city called Concord. Had a pretty rough childhood, powdered milk, putting water in my cereal when we had it, and kind of a rough upbringing.
And I grew up in Papillion, Nebraska. My father was a professor, my mom was a nurse and was a business owner, and she grew up in the traditional family, in a middle to upper class family, pretty much had anything I wanted as far as just a good household, good parents, and we had great Christmases, great families, but I grew up around mostly all Caucasian people. My family and I were first generation American. My father and my mother met in Nigeria in school, and they ended up moving to Papillion, Nebraska, just to give us a better opportunity at life. So it was a good life as a kid.
And I think the overarching umbrella of this conversation is you don't really know somebody till you have a real conversation with them. I think if we sat up here and we didn't say anything, there's a lot of assumptions that probably could be made about both of us. And our friendship was really built upon getting to know each other. And I'll let you, you want to start the story about how we met?
He'll tell you how we first met, and I'll tell you the truth of the story. So we can start with that.
So Kenny played football at University of Nebraska, Omaha. I played at Northwest Missouri State. We both played defense. We actually played each other in college. We were both All-Americans. We more or less knew who each other were, but we had never met. So I was playing for the New York Giants. He was playing for the Minnesota Vikings. And I'm sure you guys remember when the Metrodome collapsed. We actually had to go play in Detroit on a Monday night. The game was supposed to be Sunday afternoon. So I knew Kenny was on the Vikings, and I knew he was on punt team, and I was on punt return team. So Vikings got a punt. I run out there, and I'm standing across from Kenny. I'm like, hey. And he looks at me like I'm crazy because he's serious. We're the odd couple.
Dave, it's a job.
No, it was fun.
You should be serious. It's a job.
So I'm like, you live in Omaha? He's like, yeah, what are you talking about? He's like trying to get ready for the play, you know? And I'm like, we should hang out. And he's like shaking his head. The ball gets snapped. I
held.
Blocked you.
Held me.
He says I held him. It didn't get called. I probably grabbed a little cloth, whatever. He's an incredible athlete. I had to do something. So needless to say, we saw each other a couple more times during the game. Not much. I think he was pretty upset with me. He thought I was messing with him. Well, we had a mutual friend, got us in contact. I more or less had to court him in Omaha because he was still mad at me because I blocked him.
I take my job seriously.
So it was kind of interesting. More or less, I had him over to my house, and we got to know each other a little bit, and we started working out every day, four days a week, four hours.
Yep.
And I kind of like when Kenny kind of starts telling this part of the story, because I didn't really know much about it till really down the road.
I think at that time I was 25 or 26 years old, and David was the first person in my life. Now, understand my background. I grew up in a primarily white neighborhood my whole life, and I went to school in the city. I grew up in UNO, which was primarily white, and then finally got to go to the NFL. But he was the only person in my whole life, entire life, 26 years of life, that asked me what the full meaning of my name is. Now, I'm Nigerian descent, so my full name's Olaiwala Debowale Kane De Onatolu. And he asked me, what does your name mean? So my whole life, I'd been gotten made fun of because of what my name was. It was really long and really hard to pronounce. And somehow, I got Kenny out of Olaiwala Kane De Adebowale Onatolu. But that's the nickname I started to go by, and it started to stick. But my whole life, no one had ever asked me what that meant. And I actually had to go call my father. I knew some of the meanings, but all five names, I had to get all of the meanings and educate myself as well. But that resonated with me being an African-American man in a predominantly white neighborhood, never got asked that question. So Dave asking me that question, that really showed me, man, this guy's really open to learning more about me, who I am, where I'm from, and that's where it kind of started.
And it meant so much to me when he eventually had talked to me about that, because it really showed what that meant to someone if I was to ask them something of that nature. Naturally, the way I was raised in a very mixed inner city, I grew up with some Tongan families, and obviously they have it was kind of a natural curiosity that I would ask that. But when he shared that story with me, how much it meant to him, it really kind of showed me the doors that I could possibly open with my experiences and how much that would mean to a friend that looked different than me. It was interesting. So I guess I'll get to the book real quick. We'll kind of hold here for a sec. Again, The Odd Couple. Kenny literally is like, has everything written on his phone we're going to talk about today, and Wes was calling me about it. I was like, I'll take care of it. I'll be fine. So we have this idea about this book. And we're talking about it, lifting weights one day, and we thought it'd be really neat to kind of reach to the youth, because Kenny always says it great. Adults are stubborn, stuck in their ways. The kids are really malleable. So I had this idea. And about a year and a half later, Kenny emails me the book, and it's done. I'm like, what? You wrote it, and you got it illustrated and everything? And it's really been an incredible experience to kind of ride his coattails. I mean, I'm serious. He did all the work, and I'm more than happy to give him the credit that he deserves.
Yeah, for me, with the book, it was just an opportunity. I was teaching Sunday school, and a young 3-year-old girl asked me why my skin was dirty. And at that point, it resonated. It clicked in my head, like, I can really do something about this. Obviously, she's an innocent young girl, but she has not been around anyone of no any diversity, no one with brown textured skin. So that clicked in my head, and I started thinking, man, wouldn't it be great to write a children's book to introduce young kids about just learning about diversity and learning about people that are different from you, learning about culture, and just learning about things that are outside their zone. So that was the start of the book. Dave and I kind of you know, we went forward with it. We had the conversation in the weight room, and I kind of put it on paper, and it went from there.
He's really done an incredible job with that book. So to give you a little more background on kind of where our relationship has kind of developed, when I was actually in junior college in California, I was driving with a couple of my teammates to San Francisco. And this was, I had always been around people that looked different from me. But sometimes, as you all know, when you're part of a community, sometimes, especially me being white, you would have blinders on. And I was really open to how different people live their lives and all that, but I really didn't, I guess, pay attention to the peripheral as much as I could. Well, we were driving over the bridge and we got pulled over. My buddies were from Compton. And I feel the back, I feel my seat, like something hit my seat when I stopped. And I turn around and my buddy, his nickname's Brute, he had his hands on my headrest. And the guy next to him had his hands on his headrest. And the guy in the passenger seat, he had his hands on the dash. And I just stopped. I think I got pulled over for speeding. I was like, what are you guys doing? This is the police, man. I'm like, the police? Oh, I get goosebumps. It's different. Pull my blinders back. This is what it's like. And it was really an epiphany at that moment. People that don't look like me live differently than me on a day-to-day basis. And it hurt. It hurt. I don't want anybody to feel that way. Regardless of whether it's warranted or not, at this juncture, does it really matter? These young men were nervous, you know, maybe even scared about the possibility of this inconspicuous speeding situation going some way that I could never even imagine it going. And it really made me sit back and really begin a lot of these conversations that I was prepared to have but never had because I had my blinders on.
Yeah, and I think it's just about understanding that people have different experiences. Dave and I have had plenty of conversations, and I told him one about my father, who came from Nigeria, Adebowale, Onatolu, and had a master's degree in 1982 and could not get a job, so he worked as a butcher, he worked as a taxi cab driver, worked all types of odd-end jobs, worked construction as well, and it's well known in the Nigerian community that when you come to America, you take on an American name. So here's this Nigerian man, Adebowale Onatolu, going by the name, filling out job applications with the name Stan on it. So those are the conversations, right, that a lot of my Caucasian friends didn't know about. Like, this was just normal for us. Like, he wanted to get a job. He at least wanted to get an interview. So he would write Stan Onatolu on the application, and he'd get a call, and he was hoping once he got that job offer, he'd be able to show his smarts and interview well and get an opportunity. So the power of just a name, right, that maybe some of you don't think of, but is a huge deal, and we think of it.
You know, and for me personally, the growth that I've really managed with my relationship with Kenny, we were talking about it on the way down here, and I know all of us in this room, the white people, have been in a situation where something's said where you don't challenge the notion of what maybe that person had to say. And I was very guilty of that a number of times. And it wasn't until really this awesome relationship that I have with him developed that I knew if I really cared about him, I need to say something. So he got pulled over right outside of where we live in Omaha. And he should have not got pulled over. He was with his kids. The officer threw Kenny's license back at him in the car with his boy sitting in the back seat. And I couldn't believe it. And Kenny did an incredible job challenging the notion. I really supported him. I don't know what that feels like. I think that's one of the important things as well we have to understand. I don't know what it's like to be black. And I'll never know. But I can be a support. I can say things. And so this came up. And I'm not going to name names, but someone in our circle is like, why don't you just drive a different way? And I immediately turned to him and say, excuse me? Excuse me, you want him to drive a different way home? Because he might get pulled over? No. This ain't how it works around here in this country if it's according to the dream that this wonderful day is named after Dr. Martin Luther King. And I think we have to get out of our comfort zone. You have to expose yourself. And fortunately, through sports and football, I'm comfortable most of the time exposing myself. But still, there's a ton of growth for me as well. But you gotta have the ability to expose yourself to some criticism and something you might not want to hear.
Yeah, I think speaking of sports, I think sports is a microcosm of society. And I would say, I mean, even till today, we have, what, one African-American head coach in the NFL. And the NFL has been around 100 years now. Now, how does that happen? I think you have a bunch of owners from a certain dynamic, from a certain area. They all kind of think the same way. They're their own boss. They grew up a certain way, and they surround themselves with people they're comfortable around. And I think that's the issue. I think once we start looking at diversity as not just donations or charitable, but as a necessity to grow as Americans, I think we're going to have growth then. Because we think about diversity, and normally, at least in Omaha, Omaha is one of the most segregated communities in the whole country. It's the blacks on the north side and everyone else out west. I think, and there's charity is good, donation is good, but empathy and caring and looking at African Americans as something other than just charitable and donations is where we need to be. So getting out of your comfort zone, asking those questions, getting to know more about each other. I mean, that's how our friendship, we're so different. The book's called Two of a Kind. We're so different and we're so similar in the sense that, you know, we both believe in Jesus Christ. We love football, love athletics, you know, but I'm black, he's white. I'm from the middle, the upper class, he's from the lower class. But, you know, we came together because we had empathy and understanding for each other.
And I think that's what's really important is to deconstruct what you might think. I'll say this. You hear it all the time. Slavery was 200 years ago. Okay, that's not even a conversation starter. And why are there people in this room that drive somewhere and feel different than I drive? What does slavery have anything to do with that? I really want to deconstruct some of the things that we might say as white people to knock down the notion that people of color have an entirely different experience in this country than we have. And again, bend an ear, ask real questions. One of the things you hear, I got a black friend. Well, what's a friend? Eli Manning's my friend. I don't ever see him, or he don't give me no money. I call Eli, he answers the phone, he's my friend. But what is a friend? It's a relationship. Relationships need to be invested in. You have to get to know somebody. How they feel, what they think, where they're from, what does their name mean? I got lots of friends and no money. But seriously, I really wanted to deconstruct some of these things that you might think within your head and in the community. So when you are out and about and you have a friend that says something, say something to them. It's uncomfortable. But things need to change. They have to. Or it's going to tear this country apart. For the second time.
Yeah, I think that's good. The biggest thing that Dave and I were able to do was just to listen, man. if he says he's my friend, and if we got love for each other, then we're willing to open up our hearts and our minds and get uncomfortable. We've had disagreements.
We've had some about to go down a couple times.
Both prideful men, and that'd be a bad day for you. But
yes, I agree. I had to pretend though.
but we're both prideful men. We have disagreements, but the one thing is, we're Christian. We love each other. Love is the strongest of all, right? So if I love this man, if he loves me, then he has to be willing to listen to what I have to say and maybe not necessarily agree with it, but empathize and respect it. And I think that's why our relationship is kind of blossomed. I mean, if you'd have asked us when we were playing 2013, where we're running and working out, we'd be here right now talking about this. We'd have told you, you're crazy. But here we are now. So we understand that we have a platform. And it's the NFL. We had a unique opportunity to play a child's game for a living, and we excelled at it. And now we're here for this very special reason. And I mean, it's just, we're really just honored that we're sitting here on MLK Day and talking about diversity. And just really, it's a simple concept, but really, really hard for people to do, to get out of your comfort zone. I think anyone who's ever played sports here understands being uncomfortable is where growth happens. You know, training camp and running lines and wondering why are we here, what are we doing, but you're doing it to achieve a common goal. And for America, what is that goal? I think everyone wants unity, right? So you got to get uncomfortable to get there.
And I've been lucky enough to travel, play football in Europe. I've been a couple different places. There's nowhere that has the diversity that America has. And that's the beauty of it. What's the old saying? 1,000 different ways to skin a cat. There's been many things that I've learned from my brother here when it comes to parenting. I didn't have a dad. I didn't have an example other than my coaches. Thank God for them. They were incredible in my life. But there are experiences, not just on the racial front, that Kenny has had in his life that I haven't had, that I can rely on him to help me. Now imagine if we as a country decided to really listen to people that are different than us here and build on that. It's incredible to think of what I wouldn't have if I didn't have this guy as a brother. I'd be missing a huge piece of who I am. And the beauty of it is because he's different.
Right, right.
That's the beautiful part about it. He can teach me. I mean, I try to teach him. I don't know what I would teach him. Yeah, I was pretty strong.
Yeah,
I made you stronger.
Yeah, I agree.
You made me mentally stronger, though.
Yep, amen.
But, again, I don't know. Are we going to do some Q&A? Do y'all want to do that, or are we getting tight on time? I'll let you wrap it up, brother.
Yeah, that's just my advice. Our relationship, I think it's just normal. I think it's what it should be. And I just, if anything you take away from today is just really, really be intentional about talking to someone of a different background than you, whether white or black or different cultures, different ethnicities, because that's where growth happens, man, being uncomfortable. It's never too late. I know for me, naturally, I was always uncomfortable, but that's where I was, for me, I was open to just learning about other people, and I think Dave will say the same thing. We're honored. I still can't believe we're here. Yeah. I could never imagine this, and we're in a blessed situation, and we're going to continue doing what we do because we know it's not about us being comfortable. It's just about the message of unity and true growth in America. And the first part we have to do is just listen and be kind and have true love, not that fake stuff. Like, if you really love your brother and sister, then this is what you're going to do. You're going to be open to it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
One question. Oh. Where can they get their book?
Oh, Amazon. Two of a Kind.
All right, Two of a Kind by Kenny Onatolu. Dave, does your name make the cover?
And Dave Tollefson. My name's on it?
It's in the back somewhere.
Okay.
Please give it up for our friend. One of my colleagues and mentors in the 3D Institute has a mantra that he lives by. It's one that's rubbed off on me. It's become a partly a filter for decision-making in my life, and I want to share that with you all today. Here it is. For that which matters most, if I can, I will. Let me say it again. For that which matters most, if I can, I will. But that begs a question, doesn't it? What matters most? Well, to me, what matters most, or at least what should matter most, are those things that matter to God most. The things that pertain to faith, hope, and love. And as I read Scripture, the words in red especially, the words of Christ, it's evident that what matters most, what's nearest and dearest to the heart of God, are us, His children, all of His children. And that we figure out somehow how we can become a functional family. That we take care of each other as brothers and sisters. Especially those who get left behind. In fact, I'm reminded of the words of Christ when He said, "Truly I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these, brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me." Jesus identifies with the least of these. MidCity Excellence is doing the work of God. They are doing the hard work of transformation with some of the most vulnerable in our community on the front lines. Their mission was stated earlier: to transition at-risk youth in our community, into adulthood for academic success, emotional stability, and to discover and live out purpose and value according to Christian-based principles and values. Now, with a mission like that, I can stand here with a great deal of confidence, and I can tell you, God is with them. He's for them. He's inclined towards their mission because of what Jesus taught us. Do you see that? And if you do, can you see that as your invitation to get involved? See, another one of my mentors, Pastor Brian Zond, are you here? Something he said years ago that stuck with me. He said this, and it just made sense to me as a person of sport. He said, one of the wisest things that we can do with our lives, coordinate our lives with divine momentum. One of the wisest things we can do as human beings is to recognize what God is already doing and then coordinate with that. Coordinate our lives with divine momentum. Momentum. What is that? It's like a move of the Spirit. I don't know. In a sporting event, it's tangible almost. You can sense it. You can feel it. When the spirit of the crowd unifies in pursuit of a common goal and it energizes a team, it's a real intangible thing, and it's a strange phenomenon. But I get it. And therefore, if God's got momentum, I want to be coordinating my life with that. I want to follow His leader. In a football analogy, guys, if he's lead blocking, let me just get him behind. Why wouldn't I follow him through that hole? One of the wisest things we can do is coordinate our lives with divine momentum. And for that which matters most, if I can, I will. The question is, will you? Will you coordinate your life with divine momentum? In just a moment, I'm going to give you an opportunity to do just that. How? By sowing financial seeds into a good field that's producing a good harvest. MidCity Excellence, is their goal this year is to work with 300 at-risk youth in our community. 300. That's a lot more of our leaders, future leaders of this community, that are then in this room. Earlier, I asked the question, how can we join the fight for unity in a meaningful way? And much of this program has been about challenging us to get outside of our comfort zones, to learn each other's stories, to pursue those relationships with people that don't look like us as a good initial step towards racial reconciliation. That's great, and we should do that. But it's also important to put our money where our mouth is, because where our treasure is, our heart will be. Another way to get involved is to make sure that organizations like MidCity Excellence have the financial resources they need to do the hard work of transformation in our community. And at this time, I'd like to challenge each and every one of us to indeed coordinate our lives with divine momentum and give toward this good cause. For those of you that can, will you help? There are two ways you can give. First, at your tables. If you rummage around there, you should be able to find some envelopes. And that has all the opportunities to give through the envelope. And we'll tell you what to do with those envelopes in a moment. Others of you that are a little more tech savvy, you can scan the QR code. Aaron, if you've got that, you can put that up behind me. But it's also on your sheet. Aaron, is there another one that says with a giving tab? Okay. Well, what you do is you pull out your phone, and you should just, if you have a smartphone, you should just point the camera right at that QR code, and it will populate a link that you can click on. If that doesn't work for you, just go to visitmce.org, click on the Donate tab, and you can make your gift online. To give you time to execute your giving, and Aaron, we are going to go ahead and play that last video with Alex. We're going to play one more video. Now, this one comes out of our 3D training. You know, years ago, we started a conversation about what would it look like if we, as a company, the 3D Institute, started providing resources for coaches. You heard it firsthand from Dave. Kenny didn't elaborate on it as much, but the opportunity that coaches have to begin the right conversation in really what is one of the most high-functioning and diverse atmospheres that we have in our society. We call it a locker room, where people from all kinds of backgrounds come together in pursuit of a common goal. And so this is a module that we created to inspire coaches. And while Alex, one of my teammates at the 3D Institute, challenges coaches and athletes with this message, what I want you to hear is, how can this challenge you as a community member? And while the video plays, please take the time to make your gift, and we'll bring it home after the video. Thank you.
Earlier, we pointed out that coaching is as much of an art as it is a science. Yes, we want you to pursue excellence at the science of sport, the first dimension, but we also want you to pursue excellence at the art of coaching, the second and third dimensions. Speaking of art, check out this picture of an ancient mosaic. It's somewhere around 2,000 years old. As you look at it, what do you see? Do you see a perfect picture? Of course not. That's because, just like our teams, it's made up of a lot of imperfect pieces. And these pieces are all unique, different shapes, different sizes, and different colors. But this is a good thing, because if there's no contrast in the pieces, what do you have? It sure wouldn't be art. Not good art, anyway. It's the diversity of the pieces that makes it good art. And while this type of diversity is necessary for good art, I submit that it's also necessary for a good team. Diversity is the understanding that each individual is unique and has different talents and strengths that need to be incorporated into the team. So, together, everyone achieves more team. That's the essence of a team. These talents and strengths come through all different types of people. And in an inclusive environment, these talents and strengths complement each other to form a beautiful mosaic of diversity. There are a lot of problems in our world right now when it comes to issues of diversity or lack of diversity. And we certainly don't have all the answers, but that's okay. Because sometimes it's enough just to ask the right questions. Here's one to think about. What are things that block us from being able to see each other's talents and strengths? Remember this, we all have blind spots or biases in how we evaluate and judge people. This doesn't make us bad people, it just makes us typical people. I don't know about you, but I'm not satisfied with being typical. The atypical thing to do is to adopt and maintain a posture of humility, to keep our head on a swivel and keep our eyes open for those blind spots, and most importantly, to embody willingness to renew our minds once we see them. It's about an intentional openness of the mind and an intentional openness of the heart to rethink and reform. And as a coach, to help our athletes do the same. See, our brains come up with all these assumptions and conclusions based on misguided instinct. Instincts to pursue things that make us feel comfortable, safe, and protected. These instincts are mostly based in fear, and we need to recognize that. These fear-based assumptions work in our subconscious and typically come from personal experiences, how we were raised, the environment we grew up in, and whose voices we listen to, whether in person or through the media. We must be aware that these unconscious biases become barriers to our relationships. We must get beyond them to see the inherent value each player and coach have to the team. And we must be intentional about unleashing that diversity of talent to shine on the courts and the fields. Here's another question to ponder. What are we doing? No, that's a verb, an action item. What are we doing as coaches to create an inclusive environment where each player and coach feel at home in the program? There's no place like home. I think it really all just boils down to the golden rule. Do for others as you would want them to do for you. If everyone would live that out, we wouldn't even need this module. While we can't control what everyone else does, as leaders, we can control what we model. Let's be those who model the golden rule. Let's be those who model inclusion. When a team has an inclusive environment where everyone on the team is willing to invest themselves fully, that's when the beauty and excellence of diversity takes over. That's what we need. Our world needs that beauty and excellence to spill out into the streets like never before. There was so much division and dissension, so many us versus them rivalries that drive wedges between people. Sports provides an ideal platform to demonstrate to the rest of the world what it looks like for people of different backgrounds to come together for a common purpose. If we can all work together as a community of coaches to embody the original definition of what it means to compete or strive together on this issue, perhaps we can show forth the beauty and excellence of this truth. In reality, there is no us, there is no them. When it comes to our shared humanity, there is only us. And any so-called enemy we have is actually just someone whose story we've not yet heard.
Thank you so much, Wes. Thank you, David and Kenny, for being here again. We are about ready to wrap this up, and we are ahead of schedule. This is a rare moment. I want to just do a few things as we wrap up. If you're making a check out today, it goes to MCE. That's K-I-M-B-E. No. MCE. For Mid-City Excellence. It's 100% tax deducted. I would like our board members, they're gonna carry around buckets and collect, and our board treasurer is here. So the board members, if you can pass the buckets in, board members that are still here. And they're gonna come by, and then we have some staff too that are assisting that will go in and out and collect. And we thank you so much for giving of your time and your energy today, and also for the investment in the youth of right now, not our future, but the youth that are leading and becoming engaged in community events today. We want to thank LaTanya Williams Photography for being here and for being a board member and a parent. And Dax Videography, who's her counterpart, thanks for being here. For Demetrius and Dr. Chance for your support and for your videography service in graphic arts for making today's a success. Tomorrow, now we have more events going on all week, but tonight at 7, many of us are going over to Greater Jesus Tabernacle, which is formerly Wyatt Park Baptist, and it's on 28th and Mitchell, and we have a church service, and Pastor James Foster is hosting it, formerly Pastor, my father, Bishop James Foster, pastored for 47 years, and we're going to go over there and do some hand clapping and foot stomping. It's a little bit more informal, more music, and a good preach word, so please come over. We won't hold long at 7 o'clock. Tomorrow, Missouri Western, my husband's alma mater, they're having events all week, but tomorrow, they are going to honor our very own Brandon Birch. You didn't tell me that. Brandon Birch as a drum major for justice for the Student of the Year Award. I added all that extra. And also LaTanya Williams will be honored as the community leader for her directorship at Bartlett Center and being on the St. Joseph School Board, Mid-City Board, awesome mom, and so much more. So this is just the kickoff and the springboard for a whole week. Go to their website and see the other events that are going to be happening in the community. This is not just a one-hit wonder. This is going to last all year, right? Right. So thank you all for being here today. We have Ron Lewis. You have won some movie passes. Ron Lewis is on our drum crew. Where are you at? Ron Lewis, the drum crew. Take that family to the movies. God bless you. We're going to ask in closing remarks today, our board chair, Reverend Mary McDonald, who has been an executive at Behringer for many years, and I think she's busier now in her retirement, but Reverend Mary McDonald is also a pastor of Hosey Chapel, IMC. Yeah, I got it right. So we'll have her come and close our program today. Thank you all for being such a wonderful audience, and God bless you. Jay with Specialty Industries. Come back. That's the cliffhanger. Come back for more. Should we tell him no?
So Olaiwala means the crown has come home. Adebawale means wealth into wealth. And Kainde means second born of twins. So anytime you hear the name Kainde, it means they have an identical twin. And the twin's name's Taiwo. So I have a lookalike running around.
So much. What a wonderful day of sharing and caring and compassion. God bless you. We'll have Reverend McDonald to come at this time, who's leading our board and leading us into 2022.
I'm going to say praise the Lord because y'all heard I'm a pastor, right? Amen. I thank God for the opportunity to be a part of this great organization. I thank God for the vision that was cast with my brother and my sister in their heart from heaven, and the fact that you have been so bold in your commitment and determination to run with the vision and see it fulfilled. When we come to a setting like this, we've heard lots of things that are what I would call food for thought. The big question I think that we should ask ourselves as we think about leaving here is, what is it that I can do to make things better? What is it that I can do to make a difference? Well, this pastor has a scripture from Micah, the 6th chapter and the 8th verse. And the question is asked, what is required of us? What is it that we should do? And the prophet records these words. He says that we should do justly, that we should love mercy, that we should walk humbly with our God. And if we can keep that at the forefront of our mind and be a guide for our actions, I believe that the world will be a better place. I thank God for Mid-City Excellence. I thank God for the reminder that it is steps, small steps that add up to big steps, that it's hands-on, that it's investing, not just your prayers. Sometimes we say, I'll pray for you, but it's investing some skin. Whether it's your finances, whether it's your time, whether it's looking for ways that you can let some young person know that we believe in the image of God that they are made in. Amen. Now, preachers and a mic is a dangerous thing, so we're going to pray now. We don't want to mess up all the good things that have been said, so let's do that. Can we bow our heads? Father God, we just thank you for the glory that you are manifesting in this moment. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for the fact that you give us opportunities to see what can happen when we can come together and agree upon the love that you have shown this world and agree upon the fact that if you made us, we matter. Hallelujah. So I pray now, Father, that you'll continue to infuse this organization with your heart, with your vision, with the fullness of who you are. That you will continue, Father God, to put upon the hearts of all of our community the question, what can I do to help make things better? We pray a blessing upon all who have come, a blessing upon all that has been given, a blessing upon all that has been received. And Father God, we just ask now that you continue, hallelujah, to let the light from heaven shine and cause us to be determined to reflect it, hallelujah, that all might know that there is hope. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. God bless you and God keep you.